Hello students, welcome to EPG Patsala. I am Dr. Nagarajan from National Institute of Immunology, New Delhi. I am basically a veterinarian and a scientist working on the laboratory animals. Today, we are going to discuss the module Animal Handling and Experimentation from the paper Molecular Therapeutics. In this lecture, we could learn about why animals are used in research, types of mouse models that are used in research, how to handle and restrain the procedures for animals used for research, and various injection procedures used in particularly in mouse model, and various administrative procedures in animals. Why we need mouse? Why we not need birds, rats, other animals like elephants, tiger? Mouse are mammals. People are also mammals. And many human diseases can be authentically modulated in mouse. What you call it as changing the gene, or how we create knockouts and transgene, where we insert the gene. And this is how we can mimic the human disease in mouse model. And this has a very short breeding cycle. You mean 21 days. You can get enough pups every 21 days. The animals will continuously be in estrus. And the animals will continuously start to get pregnant after delivering, and it have a large litter size. And the mouse genome is closely related to the human, and we have the extensive genetic knowledge of the mouse models. Now we can study about some of the details of the animals and the strains used in the biomedical research. One is inbred strains, the other is F1 hybrids, the third one is co-isogenic inbred strains. Fourth one is congenic inbred strains and recombinant inbred strains, genetic modified strains and outbred stocks. This all comes under the heading mouse actually, because in case of mouse, we can modify so much of genes according to the research or type of mutations. If you see the diagram, biodiagram, you can see the mice model is mostly used. And secondly comes the rats, and third comes the rabbits, and even amphibians and fishes are also used, like zebrafish and non-human primates, carnivores like dogs, like what you call as big dogs, and farm animals like sheep and goats. This is a graphical representation to show you what is among the varieties of inbred strains of mouse model. For example, if a receiver and a donor which are in homozygous condition and mate for many generations, we can get inbred mouse. When there is a spontaneously or any induced or target mutation occurs in a particular inbred mouse at a different segment, we could see that we can develop, there will be a model called co-isogenic strains. And when the two inbred mouse are bred, for example, one strain like Bauxi and one strain of Blacksi are mated to get a hybrid, we call it as F1 mouse, what you call as F1 strain. When the F1 strain mouse are brother-sister mated for more generations, they become an recombinant inbred strains. And there, if there is any repeated backcrossing of the F1 mouse to the receiver strain, and it becomes a consumic strains. These are the various mouse strains that have been created for study of many diseases and for many researches. This is a pictorial diagram, not a pictorial diagram. It's a good website where you can see the details of all mouse strains available in all part of the world. And if you enter into the website, you can see what are the strains available, what are the genotypes, what are the panels, what are the QTL intervals and everything, what are the details of all the mouse strains can be observed and seen and can be used particularly what you need actually. For example, if you want to study certain disease like diabetic, you can, if you just click in the strains and see what are the mouse models can be available for study of diabetes, this can clearly demonstrate it. It's a good website to show the details of the mouse strains. This is another website, what you call as rat genome database, where you can see all the strains of rats. The first slide what you have seen is about the strains, about the mouse strains. This website show you the diseases, strains availability, what are the genome tools, what are the functions available in rats. Now, we will talk about something about transgenic mouse and a knockout mouse. Transgenic mouse is nothing but a foreign gene is inserted into the gene of a normal mouse so that it will resemble the disease aspect of a particular disease. For example, another type of genetically modified mouse is knocked out mouse, where a particular gene of interest is removed out so that the animal will have the genome which is losing the particular gene. For example, this is how a mouse model with transgenic is abbreviated. Say C57BL6J/transgenic HBA. This is something like a transgenic mouse is created by introducing of hemoglobin alpha chain, and so that this mouse will have transgenic mouse of human alpha chain, where the gene of HBJ is inserted to the mouse. The other comes to a knockout, where you need to remove a particular gene. For example, this is a BALB/c-J mouse, where interleukin 10 gene is completely removed from the genome of the mouse. So what we call it as knockout mouse, where the particular gene is removed. Before going to know about the procedures in mouse, we should know about some interesting features of a mouse. You know, mouse are mostly active in the night and delight in making nests. That's why we call it as nocturnal animals. And if you see the mouse activities in the day, it will be very lethargic. And in the night, it will be very active. They have poor visions, but very good hearing. They can recognize very small sound of ultrasonic, up to the ultrasonic levels also. Mice also have a high development of sense of smell, and it is a good produce, that is how the olfactory pheromones are easily communicated. The pheromones which is coming from the mouse helps in to communicate male and female for many reproductive studies. The mouse has don't have any sweat glands, it can't pant, and it can't ability to salivate is very limited. In fact, mouse doesn't vomit also. So the thermoregulatory mechanism is more important in a laboratory mouse. So an ideal temperature and humidity should be maintained properly in an animal facility. These are some common strains which are used for many research from immunological, toxicological or genetic studies. One of the more important, which is most commonly used, is C57 black sits mouse. And the second most common is BALB/c mouse. The outbred strain like CD1 mouse is also used for many toxicological studies. The first mouse study like BALB/c or black sits are mostly used for immunological, any genetical research, because they both are inbred mouse and the CD1 mouse is outbred mouse, which can be used for toxicology studies. This is some of the immunocompromised mouse and some of the mutated mouse actually. The first one is nude mouse, where the T cells is completely depleted and the mouse doesn't produce T cells. So, and the other mouse is killed, what you call a severe compromised immunodeficient mouse model, which lacks both T and B cells. And these two models has a wide application in cancer and many gene therapy and many stem cell therapy research. The below what you see is a DBDB mouse, which is completely lacking. It is a mutated mouse, where the leptin gene is mutated, so the mouse becomes obese and it develops diabetes, and this mouse model can be used for diabetic research. This is one of the main criteria how to differentiate the male and female in a mouse actually. In case of male, if you could see the distance between the anus and genital, it is larger, but in case of female, and it is very shorter. This is more important criteria when doing an animal research. So, sexing of the animal is more important, because you can't do any male reproductive studies in female if you don't identify the sex properly. This is some small picture demonstrating how your day old pups looks like, and you can see they are very red and eyes and ears are very shut. That means they are very closed. You can see the white color spot in the abdominal region, what we call it as milk spot. This is due to the nursing with their mothers. This is the second, by day 7, how the white mouse, like what you call it as black sits, what we already seen, and the white mouse, what you call as BALB/c, how it has developed the fuzz actually. And during day 8, how the stomach is enlarged and the fuzz are developed. And in case of female, on the 9th day, we can see the pairs of nipples where you could not see in males. And more pups, that is on day 10, how it is completely filled with all fur, hair, and its muscular activity is more increased. You can see the eyes start to open only on the 11th day after delivery of the mouse, and 12th and 13th day only the eyes will be open and they can able to feed food. By 3rd week of egg, the pups become very active, and you can see the hairs are well developed, the eyes are open, the ears are very straight, and the 3 weeks the pups are ready to get weaned is the term used to say, generally separating pups from the mother so that they can live individually. And about 6 to 8 weeks, you know, all the experiments are done mostly on age 6 to 8 weeks, where the complete adult stage of the mouse is reached. So it can be performed, the experiment can be performed at 6 to 8 weeks of age in mouse. Now we'll talk about something about animal handling and restraint and how we are done mouse models, which is, this is more important for an immunological research and for many other research. If you don't handle the mouse properly, your research will not get good results, and there will be variation in the results, and the animal, there will be stress to the animals also. This is how a mouse is handled. You can see the house, the first slide, how a person lift the mouse with the 2 fingers, and how the mouse is handled in with a one hand actually. If you don't properly handle this mouse, there will be stress and the animal will die. See, this is the how the mouse is grasped between the thumb and the forefinger, and maintaining a grip on the tail. The animal is then secure and it can be examined or injected safely. If you are holding properly, there won't be any biting between of the mouse. One of the important points to remember is always pick the mouse in the middle of the tail. Sometimes if you pick on the tip of the tail will come out and the mouse will go around. So always pick the mouse at the middle of the tail. And during holding, it is very important to hold the scuff very properly. If you hold it too tightly, the mice will not breathe, and it will, the tongue and the turn into pinkish to blue, and after some time there will be a breathing problem and the animal will die. So the handling and holding the mouse in properly in the scuff region is more important. This is some of the reproductive and biological data of your mouse which you should understand. For an adult weight, the male will be around 20 to 40 grams. The maximum weight will be 25 grams. 40 mouse is something like diabetic mouse or obese mouse. And usually the mouse weight will be not more than 25 grams. And the lifespan is 2 to 3 years. And the body surface area is 0.03 to 0.06. And the number of chromosomes present is 40. The temperature, the rectal temperature, what people had done is 37.5. And the respiratory rate is around 138 average. It will go up to 180 also. The heart rate, if you see the heart rate, it is 470 per minute. It is some comparatively higher when you compare to the human beings. As you know, the human beings, the maximum heart rate is 72 to 80. And you can see the heart rate is so high in mouse model. And the water required, how much of water a mouse will drink is 3 to 7 ml per day. And the urine excretor will be not more than 1 to 3 ml per day. Show you about the reproductive and biological data of mouse. The mechanism of ovulation is spontaneous. The time of ovulation is 2 to 3 hours, and the breeding season is all around the year. And the gestation period is, the pregnancy period is 21 days. And the litter size, the how many pups you can, the mouse will deliver is 8 pups. And the birth weight will be very little, 1 to 3 grams, and the weaning age, where we separate the pups from the mother is 21 days, and the weaning weight, that is after separation, what will the pups weight will be 10 to 12 grams, and after delivery, usually the mouse will become estrus, will come to estrus immediately rather than giving a prolonged time for coming into the estrus as in other mammals. And one of the most thing which everyone should know is identification of the mouse actually, because identification plays an important role, because you want to study 4 to 5 animals and you are going to give different batches and with different drugs regime, and you want to know which mouse has reached, given which dose, and what is the effect of the dose and everything. So the marking system of the mouse identification, what I mean to say is identification of the mouse is more important. Nowadays one of the method is ear marking. Nowadays there are many tags available and chips also available which can be identified very easily. One of the other, after identification of the animal, the other thing which we is more important for us to know about the injection procedures, because we need to inject any drugs or anything, either by intraperitoneally or subcutaneously or intradermally or intravenously. The most common procedure in mouse model where we inject is intraperitoneal injection. In during the intraperitoneal injection, should always disinfect the area with any disinfectant, and the angle of injection is 30 to 45 degree angle caudal to the umbilicus and lateral to the midline. This is one of the more important thing which we should ensure when you are injecting properly into intraperitoneal. If you don't inject properly into the peritoneum, there are many problems will occur in the intestine as well as the urinary bladder. So while injecting into the peritoneal region, you should always try to aspirate the needle, aspirate the syringe, so that if you could find any greenish, brownish or any type of aspirate coming from the aspirate, it means that you are not injecting into the peritoneum, you are penetrating into the intestine. And sometimes you can give, if you find some yellow aspirates, you are very confirmed that you are not injecting into the peritoneum and you are injecting into the urinary bladder. And this makes very knowledgeable to know where we are injecting. So it is very important to inject intraperitoneally properly, otherwise intestine and bladder will get affected. More oftenly, the size of the gauge which usually used for intraperitoneal injection is usually 25 to 27 gauge needle, and it is injected at a 45 degree, 30 to 45 degree angle. And after injecting, you have to aspirate it to ensure whether the needle is properly placed inside the peritoneal region or else region. Just aspirate it. If you find a greenish brown aspirates, that means your needle is not inside the peritoneum and it is going to the intestine. And if your yellow aspirate is there, that means you are penetrating into the bladder. So it is more important to inject properly so the intestines or bladder will not be affected. And most possible needle size should be 25 to 27 gauge, which is commonly practiced in mouse. The second most common type of injection is subcutaneous injection, where you can restrain the mouse by the scuff method and use by your thumb and the forefinger, you make a tent like what you see in the figures and make a tent over the scuff region, and usually we'll clean the area with any disinfectant or like 70% ethanol, and after that aspirate prior to make injection so that no aspirate is coming, so that it is lying properly in the subcutaneous region. And this is the figure exactly shows how to inject subcutaneous in case of mouse. This is a nude mouse. The same type of injection is done using a tent over the scuff region of the mouse so that the cancer cells or any cell lines can be injected properly subcutaneously. This is the third injection, that is what you call it as intradermal injection, and where we do for any rising antibody or going for rheumatic arthritis injection like collagen injections or anything like that, we go for intradermal, where the mouse is usually anesthetized and the area of the site of injection should be cleaned properly, and between the small area we have to inject with 25 to 26 gauge of needle. This is the figure showing you how to inject properly. Another important procedure what we regularly to do with giving some drugs orally, if you want to go, this is called as gavaging. Gavaging is nothing but giving drugs orally. We have commercially available gavage needle, what you call it as oral needle, and it can be fitted approximately with an appropriate syringe, and it can be the oral drugs which you want to deliver can be delivered orally using this gavage needle. This is the figure, this is the picture showing how the oral gavage needle exactly looks, and with the needle of the tip you can see the blunt like a round edged, so that it will not harm when you go into the esophageal regions. The other method which is commonly used for injecting any drugs or any cells into the mouse model is intravenous. See, usually the intravenous injection is done in the tail region of the mouse model. There are where the vein or artery could be seen easily in the tail region, and it is a little bit tricky procedure where you need prior experience to handle it. This is a picture showing you what is the root and what is the maximum volume you can give it. You can subcutaneously, you can give 2 ml, and for intraperitoneal, you can give 2 ml. This is the maximum volume where you can give by intraperitoneal or subcutaneous. But intravenous, you should not go for more than 0.5 ml. And intramuscularly, usually people don't practice because we'll try to injure the sciatic nerve where it lies in the thigh region. So in subcutaneous, intraperitoneal, intravenous, intradermal are usually practiced in most models. And these are the types of gauges. That is that what you mean to say, the needle size is usually used. You can see 25 gauge needle is used for tail vein and 27 gauge for intradermally, and rest of the thing 25 to 22 gauge needles are used. Maximum volume of injection in ml used for injection of aqueous antigens per root of injection for mouse. In a mouse, for subcutaneous, it should not go more than 0.5 ml, and for intramuscular, 0.05 ml. For intraperitoneal, it should not be more than 1 ml. Intravenous, it should not be more than 0.2 ml. And intradermal, it should be very, very less, 0.05 ml. This, the volume of the solution or antigen should be recommended as per this route is more important. Otherwise, there will be many problems. It will interfere in your research. This is the same thing what I already had seen, where mouse, in case of mouse, what is the volume of injection should be used for any antigens. See, coming to the main point, the mouse is a mouse blood is more usually people collect blood for any research. So it is important to know and know the volume of blood available in a mouse and how much volume of blood can be collected at a particular interval of time for your studies. So you can't take 100 to 200 microliter of blood daily in a mouse. The animal will die after some time and interrupt your research. So ethically, it's bad to take regular bleeding in mouse model. Say for example, for a mouse, usually it has 1.2 A2 ml of whole blood. That is the total volume of blood in a mouse. And you should not collect more than 200 microliters. And the collecting interval should be around 14 days interval. This is more important for any studies, and it will give the animals will not have also have no problems, and the health of the animal will also be very good. Intravenous injections and blood collections. The following are the volume recommendation for acute intravenous fluid administration and blood collection in an adult mouse. That is, for an adult mouse, what I already told, the adult mouse will be more upward from 20 grams to 25 grams body weight. And the safe injection volume intravenous, you mean to say injecting into the trail vein, is 0.2 ml. And total blood volume which you can collect from your mouse, which is present in your mouse, is 1 to 2.4 ml. And the safe bleed volume, what you mean to say is how much volume of blood you can collect at a particular time point for performing your experiment is 0.1 to 0.2 ml. What you mean to say 200, not more than 200 microliter. And two, if you are collecting 200 microliter at one point of time, there should be a gap of 14 days interval. If you are collecting 100 microliter at one point of time, there should be 1 week gap interval. So it is more important to maintain the volume of blood collected so that it will not interfere with research, the animal health will not be affected, and it is ethical, and the animal will not have any problem in your research. Now, what is the intravenous injection and blood collections? Safe injection volume for intravenous is 0.2 to 0.5, and total blood volume, what I told already, in a mouse is 1.2 to 2.4 ml based on the body weight, and the safe bleed volume is 0.1 to 0.2 ml, that is 100 to 200 microliter in a 20 gram mouse and a period of 14 days interval. This is one of the methods where you want to collect large amount of blood in a mouse. For example, 200 to 300 microliter of blood collection is needed for a particular study. It is very difficult to collect blood from the tail tip where you can collect more than 100 microliter of blood. So one of the best method which is internationally accepted, and it's a guidelines frame from the all over the world, is retroorbital sinus bleeding. Retroorbital sinus is the sinus region where the plexus meet at the eye, where you should go for a proper anesthetic before doing any blood withdrawal. This is very, very important while collecting blood volume in a retroorbital sinus. Usually anesthesia, what we perform use is ketamine xylazine. So the animals will be very free and it will not have any pain or any distress into the animal. And it is a very convenient and easy method to collect the mouse if you adapt anesthesia properly. And from by this method, you can collect maximum up to 300 microliter or 0.3 ml in a 25 to 30 grams mouse. This is a small drop of blood how you can collect from the pricking the tip of the vein at the tail region, where you can get 100 microliter. And if you want to collect more than 200 to 300 microliter of blood, and you have the option is retroorbital sinus, actually, where anesthetic protocol is usually practiced, and without anesthesia you should not bleed mouse from the retroorbital sinus. This is a picture, so where is the how you collect the blood from the retroorbital. You can see the eye where there is both, we can see inner and outer canthus, and with the capillary tube, then with capillary action the blood will be coming out from the eye. This is nothing but we are pinching inside the plexus of the retroorbital eye in case of eye. This is usually done using anesthesia. This is another picture showing how blood is collected after anesthesia. This is the another method where the animal is restrained and the blood is collected via trail vein, where not more than 200 microliter of blood can be collected. Nowadays, people started using bleeding from the facial vein, what you call as submandibular bleeding. There is a artery vein which is present in the facial region. And by puncturing the small, not puncturing, just pricking the small area in the vein region, the bleeding can be collected easily. Blood can be collected very easily. This is a table showing what are the anesthetic commonly used for laboratory animal experiment. For example, for retroorbital bleeding, what are the anesthesia we use? And for any surgical procedure, what are the anesthesia we use? Usually for inhalation anesthesia, we use isoflurane. Or if you go for any drug anesthesia like xylazine and ketamine are commonly used anesthesia in case of mouse or rat or rabbit or guinea pigs. If most of the common, ketamine is a good anesthesia and xylazine is a muscle relaxant. And in case of inhalation anesthesia, the recovery period is very good and the animal will recover easily after the anesthetic. But in case of ketamine xylazine, the recovery period is very slow. And some of the anesthesia depends on the study, what you want to do. And certain anesthesia will depends on your studies because they may interfere your research also. So anesthesia should be considered properly before doing any procedures. What needles are used and what is the maximum volume of blood can be collected from a mouse, from a rat, from a rabbit and from a guinea pig. This is a blood, how it is collected from a rabbit. In rabbit, the blood is collected from the ear, not from the other veins. Usually they are collected from the ear. The picture show you how the blood is collected from a rabbit. Usually pre-anesthetic medication is done, or any lignocaine or anything, local anesthesia is used to avoid pain to the animal. This is a metabolic cage where we can collect the urine from your mouse. And this is helpful in for many metabolic studies and for other research. This is a picture showing how your blood pressure is monitored in a mouse, and this instrument is really available for research and carry out how blood pressure is done. See, there are human endpoints and euthanasia which is regularly practiced in while working on animal research. What is euthanasia? It is a messy killing of the animal when it has many problems, that is, pain cannot be reduced, it cannot withstand the pain, or it can't feed properly, and it is very lethargic and body emaciated. Instead of suffering from that, from the pain or the body conditions or weak animal, it is better to go for a euthanasia. There are many methods of euthanasia, or what you call it as human endpoints, which is commonly practiced in laboratory animals. First of all, we should think what are the criteria in advance before going for any euthanasia or human endpoints. For example, if it is a moribund animals or it have a solid tumors, if the tumor size is very big, so that it is unable to move or it cannot take feed, it cannot drink water, then this is more important. And such case, it is better to euthanize this animal rather than keeping the animal with unnecessary sufferings. And how we can do? There are many tranquilizers, sedatives, anesthetics, analgesic. These are the things which you should use before going for any euthanasia. And the other points we should be considered is there should be a good professionalism and sensitivity of the personnel. The person should be able to do very complete euthanasia. A layman or inexperienced person, when handling the when he is doing an euthanasia, there will be so much of problems. So a well-known, knowledgeable person who has the ability to have euthanasia in a proper month should be usually recommended. And finally, after euthanasia, we have to see whether the animal is dead or not. Because if the unprofessional person has euthanized the animal, some animals may not die. And after that, they will take the animal and keep it in the freezer. And it is like keeping the live animal inside the freezer. So it is always needed to confirm the death of the animal before after the euthanasia. As already I have told you what is the difference between male and female in rat. The same exactly applies for the rat also. The genital distance is larger in males, but in case of female it is shorter. The common intramuscular injection in rabbit is mostly done to administer any antibiotics, any tranquilizers or any anesthetic agents before we all want to do any procedures in rabbits. This is a picture showing how you disinfect the skin on the top of the thigh muscles before giving any injections procedure to the rabbits. See, the area is disinfected with 75% alcohol and cotton, usually a ball of cotton is used to disinfect clearly. And this is how the ear vein looks before administering a tranquilizer into the rabbit. This is how injection procedure is done in the ear vein of the rabbit. There is another, butterfly type of needle is also available, where the ear vein is directly inserted with a butterfly needle and the blood can be collected via butterfly needle. Some of the occupational, from the previous slides, you have seen some of the procedures and how the blood collections and how to handle the animals. But there are some occupational health and injuries and allergies which is commonly happening when you don't wear proper protective equipments, what you call proper dressings before entering into the animal facility or handling with the animals. And usually people develop allergy to mice over long time after having contact with them. And mouse urine is particularly allergenic and pelt proteins can also be allergic. Some people will also develop allergic like symptoms. When you see continuously having some allergic like symptoms while working on mouse model, it is advised to go for clinical evaluation. Some of the occupational health hazards which is commonly encountered in animals, that is when people work on animals, is there are some of the zoonotic diseases, what you call it as. Finally, this is important what you should consider before going for an animal research, what you call it as 3R. 3R stands like reduction, refinement and replacement. Reduction is something like using approximate animal models of numbers to minimize variation. You can't take 100 to 20 animals per groups and use for your research. Maximum animals of numbers of animals should be reduced in such a way your results will not be varied and you will get a good statistically data. Second thing is replacement. Consideration of non-animal alternatives or animal with lower sentience. So it is better to have in vitro, if your results can be available with an in vitro experiment, or small animals like mouse, rat, rather than going for your primates or large animals before, which is really and helpful to replace the animals. And refinement. Refinement is one of the important husbandry procedures. You should always keep the animals in a proper environment, both micro and macro environment, so the animals will not have any stress or any what you call any problems during housing. And during experiment, it is also more important to minimize pain by using giving proper anesthesia, proper analgesia, and what are the problems regularly observing the animals after any surgeries, and what are the complications occurring before after surgery. This should be properly addressed so that the research of the animals will be better and the output of the animal research will be better. Finally, from this lecture, you should understand how the animals are used for research, types of mouse models and strains used for research, some of the handling and experimental procedures, how you should do and what are really practiced during research, and after that you should know about some occupation, you had learned about some occupational hazards in working on animals, and finally we should consider reduction, refinement and replacement before going for animal research.